Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. So today, I'm going to do the last of my three videos talking about the New York City Comic-Con panel that discussed the future of Marvel. In my first video, I used statements from that panel to show you that Marvel has no intention of abandoning its quote-unquote progressive agenda. Far from it. Over the next few years, they plan to dive headfirst even deeper into this progressive agenda. And in my second video, I talked about how this is going to affect comics as a whole and the comic production as a whole, and how Marvel is not producing comics in themselves to make money, but they are using them as part of lifestyle branding, that is to say, part of a multi-platform advertising campaign in order to sell other products. And they don't care about comics, and they're not going to change, even though their comics aren't selling. They're going to continue to produce garbage comics with a progressive agenda all the way, even though they are losing money, because they are simply part of a multi-platform campaign to sell their money makers like the movies. And by the way, I'll link both of those videos both in the description and at the end of this video if you wish to go and listen to them. But today I'm going to talk about what the future of Marvel has in store for us as comic readers and, to some extent, as independent comic producers. Because a lot of people in my comments keep on saying, and I'll paraphrase, they say, to hell with Marvel. Stop buying Marvel comics, buy independent comics. Put your money there and they will fall. And then we will finally have a good comic producing industry once again. Now, while agreeing that that is what we should do, I think that this process that everyone thinks might happen after we stop buying Marvel comics and start supporting independent comics is that comics will rebound. But I don't think that's going to happen. And if it does rebound, it will take 30, 40 years for this to happen. And it's all because of how Marvel produces comics right now and how they intend to keep producing comics over the next several years. Because again, a lot of people in my comments are saying, well, nobody buys these, so none of this is going to matter. But I would say that Marvel actually knows that no one is really buying these comics, and that is part and parcel of what they're trying to do. Because, in effect, Marvel Comics, and to a lesser extent, DC Comics, have operational control over 80 to 90% of the shelf space at your comic store. And just as an aside, a lot of people have been asking me, yeah, that's Marvel. What about DC? Aren't they producing better comics? Well, for the moment, they are producing better comics, but they have yielded to Marvel the shelf space that Marvel needs. They have said over the last year that they are going to stop producing so many comics. They're going to concentrate on producing good comics in a smaller number. Now, isn't that good for comics? Well, yes and no. I would say the only reason why DC is doing that is because they're under the thumb of Marvel right now, and they just can't get out. But if DC had the means and were able to do so, they would be doing the exact same thing as Marvel right now. So the only reason DC is actually producing some semi-good comics is because the company is failing in this format and other formats. If they started to succeed, they would be doing the exact same thing as Marvel. And the reason why I believe this, it's something small, but I think it's something important. At last year's Comic-Con, when they had this Marvel panel talking exclusively with people who work for Marvel about how to get into comics, these people who work for Marvel kept on saying, if you wish to get into comics and work for Marvel or DC. And they said that over and over again. If you wish to work for Marvel or DC. But this was a Marvel panel, with exclusively Marvel people talking on this Marvel panel. Why would they feel comfortable saying, if you wish to work for Marvel or DC? Well, the reason why they felt so comfortable is because Marvel and DC are both this incestuous little group of comic creators. They're the exact same. DC holds its cards much closer to its chest than Marvel does, but really, the mindset of the people in Marvel and the mindset of the people in DC, they're the exact same. And if DC had the same control as Marvel does, it would be producing the exact same kind of comics. But to go back to what I was saying, Marvel and DC have operational control over the shelf space. Think about it. When you go into your comic shop in order to buy comics, what are 80 to 90% of the comics that you see on the shelf? Well, they're Marvel and DC. But let's take a step back to the first of what I just said. I said, if you go into your comic shop to buy comics. And that's the thing. The only place, really, that you're going to buy comics right now is in a comic shop. Yes, you can buy them online, but I would say 99% of comics are actually sold within the comic shop. And I have to break off into an aside here again. I would say that for North American comics, they are a physical item, all right? You have these digital comics, but they're not the same thing. It's the same as manga, all right? You have these people who are producing stories, both digitally or in manga, and they are the same format as North American comics, but they're not the same product. Because a lot of people are saying to me, just go digital and read independent comics, or just buy manga and read that. And while I do those things, they're not the same product as a North American comic. They're the same format, but a different product. A North American comic is actually a physical product, and I would say that's tied up a lot with the fact that they are collectibles. So if you wish to buy one of these products, you gotta go into your comic stores in order to find them. And the thing is that the comic stores are hurting, and I would say that Marvel has no intention of helping these comic stores out at all. I would say that Marvel is actually leveraging the fact that comic stores are hurting so badly in order to strengthen their own position. And they're doing so in the following way. Now, this just may be me, but I would say that 90 to 95% of every comic store that I have ever gone into was a small business. There are some larger chain stores, but they're few and far between. Most of them are small businesses. And the thing is that with a small business, you gotta pinch every penny. You gotta make sure that what you buy is what you're going to sell. Because if not, that's a loss for you. And the thing is that with the way that Diamond ships comics and does not allow anybody to return these comics, once you bought that comic as a comic shop, you own it and you're never going to get rid of it unless one of your customers comes and buys it. So in order for them to stay alive, they need to try to buy comics themselves that will sell. And the thing is that these comics that sell, even though they are garbage comics like Marvel and DC, they are selling because they have recognizable characters. So these other comics, even though they are better comics, some of these independent comics are far and away better comics, they're not getting ordered and they're not getting the shelf space. Because they're not going to get sold, because people simply don't recognize the cover, they don't recognize the brand, they don't recognize the character. And again, one of the comments that I get all the time is that no one is buying these comics, these Marvel garbage comics, no one is buying it, so they're going to die out soon. But I would say that Marvel knows full well that no one is really buying their comics, and they're actually factoring that into their strategy in order for them to make money as a whole for Marvel. And how does that work? Well, it works in the following way. Marvel is trying to create an insurance policy for their actual money makers, which again are the movies. We know from statements from Disney and Marvel that Marvel has a minimum 10 years planned out for their superhero comic movies. I would say they probably have a plan for 20 years ready to go for all of their movies, and they intend to stay on top as the biggest money maker, the biggest producer of superhero comic movies, and this is where they make their money. And one of the insurance policies that they have in order to maintain the fact that they are on top is to make sure that no good comics get produced again. Or if good comics do get produced, no one is going to see them. And this is the point of why they flood the shelves with garbage. I would equate it to spam. They are spamming out comics. I said this before. Because these comics, number one, for the most part, they're useless. Number two, they just take up space everywhere. On the shelf, in the backstock, in the dollar boxes, they just take up so much space. And number three, they're made by people who either A, are trying to sell you something that you don't want, or B, trying to manipulate you, or C, trying to do a combination of those two things. And what allows them to spam out so many comics every month is the fact that they have people who are garbage writers and garbage artists and garbage colorists and everything else. Because the thing is that if they had people of substance, they would cost more money. And they don't want to spend that money. Why would they spend that money on a medium where they know they're not going to make money? Compared to something like the movies, even if the comics did well, even if they did spectacularly well, they would still be making peanuts compared to the movies. So they're not going to make money off of comics, even if they do well. So why don't they take the little money that they have available to them, spread it out as far as possible over as many people as possible by hiring garbage people who will take next to nothing so that they can work for Marvel, and just produce as many comics as possible so that they can spam out as many comics as possible per month. And again, the point is to control the shelf space. It's not to sell the comics, it's to control the shelf space. Because think about it. Well, first of all, if Marvel were to stop producing comics today, DC, as I said, would just take over and do the exact same thing. But let's say we actually got a comic producer, a third-party comic producer that was concentrating on making good comics, and they wanted to make money with comics, and they were producing the best story that they could, and the best art that they could, and they were producing really good comics. There is such a hunger for these good stories and this good art right now that people would snatch it up. And within 10 years, this company would do so well that they would have under their belt 10 years worth of good stories. And they would have such goodwill with the comic readers that those comic readers would have taken these characters and brought them into the popular culture in some form. And if that were to happen, these comic producers could, in effect, challenge the future of Marvel's dominance over the product of the superhero comic movie. So, again, as an insurance policy to make sure that no one within the next at least 20 years will challenge that dominance, Marvel has to ensure that no good comics actually are made, or if some independent good comics are made, that no one sees them. By, again, controlling the shelf space and just spamming out as many comics as possible, which means they have to take what little money that they have and hand it out to as many people as possible to produce as many comics as possible, which means very unprofessional, very not ready for prime time artists and storytellers and colorists and everything else. And to ensure that they can do this and pay them peanuts to give them a wage that they are starving on, they hire people who are freelancers and say to them, listen, I know you're a starving artist and all, but if you complain, I'll just give it to somebody else. Because there's a whole lot of people that are in line behind you waiting to fill your position. And by substituting for their pay the fact that, hey, listen, you're doing something progressive. You're actually making a change in the world with your progressive product. And we're giving that progressive product and your voice a giant platform with Marvel. So that should substitute for the fact that we pay you next to nothing. And once again, in my comments, a lot of people are saying that, look at the new Marvel movies that are going to come out. They're going to fail. With this agenda, they're going to fail. And if we're going to have those movies fail, they're going to have to go back to making good comics again. And that's what's simply going to happen once these movies fail. But I would say that Marvel has such control. Disney has such control over the market that they are participating in right now, that even if these movies fail, which I agree they're going to fail, they're going to have enough breathing room to self-correct to make sure that they can keep control over the product of the superhero movie. They're simply, with this next phase, just pushing the boundaries of how far that they can go with providing people with a product that costs them as little money as possible and that is sold through nostalgia or some kind of progressive propaganda so that they don't have to, again, pay good storytellers or pay for a good story. But they do have enough control so that they can self-correct once they see that we can only go this far. And so I don't see their movies failing as a whole anytime in the near future. They're going to keep this control for the next 10 years at least, maybe 20 years. And so this control is going to trickle down to comics and keep them producing garbage comics. And as I said at the beginning, what does this mean for you and I as comic readers? What does this mean for small comic producers, whether you be a small company or someone who is crowdfunding and trying to sell comics that way? Well, it simply means that yes, we will have to stop buying these garbage products and start buying and supporting smaller comic producers and smaller comic creators. But the only way we're going to be able to find them is if we deliberately seek them out ourselves. There is very little or no way that we are going to find them on the shelves. And in effect, comics are going to have to go underground like they were 40 years ago. And you may be asking, what is this new form of underground comics going to look like? Well, honestly, I have no idea. If I did, I would be in on the ground floor of it. But I do know that Marvel is not going to give up control of the shelves. And I don't think we're going to see a healthy comic industry for 10, 20, maybe even 30 years we're going to have to go back to being, in effect, an underground movement. And if you're a comic producer, you're going to have to realize that making a really good product might not even be enough, because of the fact that Marvel is trying to stay on top. And how they are staying on top is not by being the best version of themselves, but by taking what they do have and throwing it as stumbling blocks in front of anybody who even has a chance of catching up to them. Linguistically and philosophically, it's called calumny, and it's a vice, by the way. But both as comic buyers and as comic producers, we're going to have to be fully aware that you're going to have someone throw stumbling blocks in front of you finding good comics or making good comics time and time again. And for my own part, I desperately want those heroes that I've read for so many years to actually act like heroes again. But really, in the back of my mind, I know that's never going to happen. Because if you have an entire company like Marvel, who is steeped in this vice of calumny, is steeped in the mindset of being number one, not through being the best version of themselves, but by throwing stumbling blocks in front of other people, if this is what they are, and this is what they teach to their creators on how to stay on top, there's no way that these people can understand, let alone produce a story of a paragon of virtue. That is to say, to produce a story about a true hero. So, if I've given you anything new to think about, hit like, hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe, and leave me a comment. Tell me what you think about all this. All right, I'll see you later. Bye.